Thank you very much for having me here in this great city of balsamic vinegar. I hope you are in good spirits today, because I'm going to talk sort of doom and gloom about the future of because we are now living in very interesting times, right? We are going through one revolution after another revolution, and what's happening with all these revolutions is that jobs are disappearing. Okay, so we are like living in through this great event of disappearance of jobs, right? The great extinction. But so this is the bad news, right? The good news is that the jobs of programmers are probably the last to disappear, right? Because somebody has to write these programs that would replace truck drivers, doctors, you know, who have to write all these artificial intelligence systems, the neural networks, right, that will drive the cars, that will, you know, cure people from diseases and so on, right? But not everything is great, even for programmers. We have to think about which programming jobs have the biggest chance of surviving and which ones will be eliminated, right? Because some of the things that we are doing as programmers are repetitive and boring, right? I mean, it used to be like that programming was so much fun, and it was like the most advanced thing to do. It was fascinating, you know. It's like every time we were going to work, it was something new and amazing. We're opening new frontiers. But more and more we see that a lot of programming jobs are kind of boring, aren't they? It's like there's a lot of this cut and paste, you know. It's like a lot of code there's around Stack Overflow, right? And you just look it up and you copy it and paste it. Now, you might have noticed that the jobs that are eliminated first are usually the jobs that are repetitive and boring, right? Menial jobs. So every time you see yourself doing this kind of programming where you're actually like yawning and, you know, cutting, pasting and so on, you know, think about this, that at some point the computer will take over this job. It can be automated. And in fact, you know, I believe that we are already at this level of development that we could be able to eliminate a lot of programming jobs. And the only reason why this is not happening is for economical reasons, right? I think it's still, I mean, we think of ourselves as being really well paid and, you know, it's like in demand and so on, right? But really, I think we are reasonably cheap as programmers, right? And I'm saying that because I've been working in I've been developing tools for programmers for some time, and I worked for some companies that were trying to like come up with a new IDE for Haskell or a debugging tool or a version control system, and so on, you know. What I noticed is that there is no market for these. It's like nobody wants to buy these things. Productivity tools for programmers. Why? Apparently, programmers are so cheap for companies that increasing their productivity by paying additional money for tools is not in the cards. It's not a good investment. It's like every time you want to create more code, you just hire more programmers. So that's a little bit upsetting, And we have, these big companies doing tremendous progress, especially in the area of AI, artificial intelligence, right? I mean, the neural networks, this is definitely the future of software, artificial intelligence. They are now able to beat us at chess, at Go, Jeopardy, right? And this is fantastic, and every time I see Google do something like this, win a tournament or beat the Go Grandmaster, on the one hand, I'm thinking, great, this is like progress, but on the other hand, I'm thinking, if they can do this, they can write software that can play Go better than humans. Why can't they invest this money instead in helping programmers, write software? But apparently they're not interested in doing this. And that reminds me of the situation in ancient Greece. In ancient Greece, they had these amazing philosophers, mathematicians, that there was Euclid, who came up with axioms for geometry. They have philosophers, Plato, Socrates, you name it, So they did all this development. They were really smart people, but they had no technology. Like, why didn't they have technology? There was one guy who invented the steam engine, the hero from Alexandria, right? And this steam engine was just a trick. They treated it as a toy, right? They didn't even think about, with this power, maybe we can do some technology with this, They never did that, and that, I don't know what the reason was, but one reason that comes to mind is that it was not economically feasible. That they just don't need it. They didn't need this, right? Because they had slavery. They had cheap labor, right? So why would they use steam engines and put all this effort into developing technology if they can just get more slaves, go to war, conquer some country and get slaves, And that was the simplest solution to their economic problems, right? And it lasted for thousands of years that they, whether it was slavery or peasants, who had to work for the in the fuel system or whatever. There was just no need for this. So this is kind of weird, It's like this is economy. We are here programmers. We are thinking of the technology and so on. But the economy is a major force in the development of technology. And as long as there is no push, economical push towards increasing programmers' productivity, nobody will do this. So let's think about what kind of programming jobs would be the first to go. What are the most boring jobs and require least skill, right? Well, one thing that comes to mind is the user interface code, right? And actually, there are already systems people are trying to come up with systems that would take a picture of the user interface, right? So like you do a screenshot, you know, you put buttons here and there, and then train a neural network to figure out what kind of code should go with this, right? And this is not a very difficult problem, because a good UI is something that is obvious to a human, right? That like you are looking at the screen and you see this is a button. That's something I'm supposed to press, right? I mean, if you make a little smiley face instead of a button, nobody will know that they are supposed to press it, right? If there is a link that you have to click on, you know, it has to be somehow highlighted or underscored or something, you know, it's like a choice between several radio buttons and so on. You know, I mean, all these things have to be obvious, because otherwise they are not usable. So if we humans can figure out that this is a button then that has to be pressed, an artificial intelligence or a neural network will figure it out soon enough, right? And it will provide the code that will react to the button press, right? It will not write the code of the application. It will not know what part of application it's supposed to be calling, right? But it will figure out the mechanics of button press, you know, or the HTML in order to produce these things. And they actually did this already. I've seen a paper, and it's like, wow, this is already happening, you know? It's like, these things are happening so quickly, you know? And so the job of a user interface implementer, you know, not the designer. The designer has to be a human, right? Because a human understands other humans, you know, what to do, right? But once the design is done, you know, then the neural network will go through this and provide the code, and it will do the cut and paste that's necessary for this, because, you know, it will just go to Stack Overflow and copy this code, you know, and this is, right now, this is a very difficult thing for us, because you have to write code that will work with different systems, different browsers, you know, specialize it for this browser, for that browser, for a different version of this browser, and so on. This is like such a mess. But this is exactly the kind of mess that computers deal with very well, right? I mean, they will have a database of solutions, and then we'll just pick this and paste and do this, right? So I think HTML and JavaScript, these are the jobs that would be first to go. So these of you who do user interface, don't raise your hands. You have to think about learning some new skills, and you know, so to have plan B, just in case. In case the AI comes and takes over your job. Okay, the second job that I think is on the chopping block is the human optimizing compiler. Okay, so a lot of programmers are working on writing optimal code, writing code that will run faster, right? And that they are actually paid big bucks, because I mean, if you can make this code run 1% faster, it means that our whole server farm will save $1 million per second, or whatever, you know, something like incredible sums of money, right? So, and you see what's happening, you know, it's really makes sense to hire 100 excellent programmers. You know, top-notch programmers, and pay them big bucks if they can improve the code by 1%, okay? Now this is, I consider this a pretty boring job, you know, being a human optimizer. But there are people who really enjoy doing this, and that's great. And they are extremely smart people. They come up with you know, little tweaks that can improve this performance. But you see, like, so who is here more valuable? The server farm that can save you millions of dollars per minute, you know, compared to programmers. So the economy here is really skewed, right? So let's talk about the optimization of code, right? So we already have these optimizing compilers, right? And I consider this sort of the first generation of software. The first generation of software is the generation that uses algorithms. So this is code that we do understand, right? So we write these optimizers, and they have certain rules, right? There are certain algorithms. You take a parsing tree, and you perform certain operations, right? And we have associated costs with some of these operations, what will actually improve performance, what will not improve performance, and so on. You know, there are these peephole optimizers that just go through code with a small window, and they say, you know, every time you move the register this and take this XOR, you know, instead of that, do this, you know. So it's like lots of rules. And this is the first generation of code is code that we can understand, that is based on algorithms. Right? Understanding of code, that's something that's very important to humans. But there is this second generation of software that's coming through neural networks, which we will not understand. Because neural networks are, we understand how they work, right? We see the microscopic picture. We know that these are these neurons, they have weights, they sum them up, you know, and so on. So we know how they work. But then we hit them with data, right? And we train them. And at some point, they are trained and they make decisions. And we cannot ask a neural network, how did you come up with this? You know, it's like, what kind of rule were you using? Like, how did you know that we would? And the neural network, if it could respond, it would say, oh, I don't know. Gut feeling, right? It won't be able to explain because it's not working this way. It's not reasoning. Neural networks don't reason, just know. You know? And that's kind of scary because this is what we humans do too, right? Right? They are not as smart as we are, but they are very specialized. They can specialize in, and this is you know, how much harder it is to optimize a piece of code than to win a Go tournament. Right? I mean, this is really hard to win Go, right? And this is one of the very hard problems, and it was solved finally, right? But it was solved through this second generation of software. It was solved by training neural networks. You know, maybe there were a little algorithms here and there on the side, but most of the stuff was trained. And now we are just observing this AI making really interesting moves. It's like, well, a human would never come up with this. How did you come up with this? I don't know. It's a gut feeling, you know? So what we could do is, you know, it's like, how did they train these neural networks? They made them play with themselves, right? So they analyzed some tournaments, but also this AI was playing against itself all the time and just reinforcing the good moves and weakening the bad moves. So we could do the same with software, with the optimizing, write something in a high-level language, right? And just give it to this AI and say, make it faster, okay? So this is not a very hard problem to formulate, you know? These are the moves, okay? The moves are this, you know, here's a parse tree of this stuff, you know? You can change this or move this way or that way or whatever you want, you know? So come up with new moves if you want, right? And the goal, what's the goal? The goal is run this and time it. Yeah? If it finishes faster than the previous one, well, that was a good move. And so on, right? So we could do that. We don't do that yet. Because we have cheap programmers. Right? No matter how much they are paying us, you know, it's like, you know, in the States especially, you know, the salaries of programmers are pretty high compared to other. But on the other hand, the life is much more expensive in Silicon Valley. Buy a house in Silicon Valley, it's millions of dollars. So it's all relative, right? So then I was started thinking about so if at some point neural networks will be able to take a piece of code that's written in a high-level language and optimize the heck out of it, right? What will be the best programming language for this, right? Because at this point, it will not make much sense to, well, it definitely doesn't make sense anymore to write assembly language code, right? We know that. But it won't make sense to write C or C++ or all these low-level languages, right? That just tell the computer, you know, move this stuff into register, add this, and, you know, increment the pointer and so on. This will just make no sense. And anyway, we have sort of like gone through this process and like I don't know how many of you are C++ programmers, but in C++ we just like went away from using pointers and incrementing them, and now we are using iterators, right? Soon enough we'll be using ranges and so on. So we'll like just trying to get away from hardware, from the metal, right? So we'll be trying to certain languages will just die, right? And it might not seem like this because you might be thinking, okay, right. No language dies, right? I mean, there are still people programming in Cobol, right? Fortran is very popular. Supercomputers, they're still using Fortran left and right. So languages don't die, right? But this is the same kind of thinking that dinosaurs had, right? Dinosaurs don't die, right? And then, bam, right? So something like this is going to happen because there is this second generation of software that's coming up. It's right behind the corner. It's coming, and it will kill languages, just like this meteor killed dinosaurs, right? It will happen. It's not a question whether or if, it's a question when. I don't know when, maybe 10 years, maybe 20 years, you know, who knows? But this is going to happen. So some languages will die, and the low-level languages will die first, right? And these are the languages. Why are people still using C or C++? The only reason for using these low-level languages is performance. Because if it weren't for performance, I think people would just say, okay, let's use Haskell, you know? So, I started thinking, what, you know, so what kind of languages would we use? First of all, the languages that we are using right now, like C, C++, and so on, they are imperative languages, right? Which means you are telling the computer how to do something, right? Not what to do, but how to do this. You say, you know, here's a loop, right? Do this in this loop and increment this pointer and so on, right? But there is this other type of programming, declarative programming, when you just say what to do. You say, I want you to do this thing. I want you to achieve this particular goal, right? Here's a definition of a function. Implement this function. Here's a definition of a data structure. Implement this data structure for me. Okay? Implement some functionality for this data structure. I want you to go over this data structure and change every variable, every value there incremented or something, you know? It's like, I want you to transform this data, right? This is declarative programming. And the computer should be able to figure out, or the neural network or the AI should be able to figure out how to do this in the best way, in the most optimal way, right? Maybe it will look on Stack Overflow and find out how to do this. Fine, right? It's like you should be able to give it a definition, a very simple definition of what quicksort does. You know, it's like, you know, quicksort creates a list that's sorted, right? And how does it do it? Well, it chops it in, you know, picks a pivot and sorts the one part, another part, the ones that are less than, the other that are greater than, and just combines them. Okay? So that's more of the declarative way of saying this. And it can be like written in like three lines of code in Haskell. Okay? In C++, it's a whole page of code, right? And the difference is, there's a huge difference in performance, right? The code in C++ will run a lot faster, right? But it's very error prone. Writing it, you know, debugging it. You know, people keep debugging it and they still have errors, right? But if you have this very concise definition in Haskell, you know, you can actually go ahead and prove that it's correct, right? And proving the correctness of code, it seems like such a weird thing, right? I mean, who does proofs of correctness of code? People at universities, right? And they do these proofs for like three lines of code. They prove that it's correct, right? Or maybe a little bit more, like, you know, some sorts or balancing some black and white, red and black trees, or whatever, right? Or they prove the performance of quicksort is log n log n, right? But that's not what we programmers do. Like, what do we do, programmers? Like, do we like write random lines of code and test it and see, does it work? No, it doesn't work. Well, let me just try to change something. No, that's not how we program, right? I mean, yeah, there is the style of programming, the test-driven programming, right? Which is sort of but in general, we sit and think and reason about a program, right? So we like to reason about what we are doing, right? And reasoning, it is math. Okay, this is what mathematicians do. They reason. Mathematics is the way to reason about things. So when we are reasoning about our code, we are actually doing mathematics. We are maybe not very good at it, you know? And we are not very good at it because the languages that we are using are so convoluted that it's really hard to reason about them. So in most cases, we'll just do some kind of like simplified reasoning, right? It's like, best case scenario, okay? And if something goes wrong, I don't know, we'll throw an exception, right? Something like that. Or we'll just send this code to testers. Or to users, let the users test it, right? I mean, they will complain if it doesn't work, right? And we'll fix it, we'll send them a fix, right? So this is how software development looks right now, you know. You ship some software and then you do these updates on a regular basis, right? So this is like every single piece of code has built in this ability to get updates, right? Because we know it's buggy, right? So that at least we admit this, right? Because in the olden times, nobody would admit that the code is wrong, right? But now we have the internet, so we can do these upgrades and constantly upgrade our operating systems and applications, right? And if some kind of virus hits your operating system, that's because you are bad, because you did not download the upgrade, right? That's your fault, right? Blame the user. Okay, so my point is here, and you will probably recall from this, that the language of the future, the programming language of the future, will be mathematics. The language of mathematics. Okay? I know this is like lots of programmers don't like mathematics. It's like, okay, we studied mathematics, we don't want it anymore, right? But my point is that you are doing math. You're just not doing it effectively because you are using the wrong language to do this. But we do use math. And every programming language is somewhere on this spectrum of it's for humans on the one side and for machine on the other side. So there is a trade-off always involved, right? So in the old times, this trade-off was much closer to the machine. We were programming in assembly language, and it was really telling the machine to load registers and things like this, right? And we know that this code is perfectly good for the machine, right? And in fact, you know, we use compilers, we take this high-level code that we write, and what does the compiler do with it? It turns it into gibberish, right? It's totally impossible to understand this code. I mean, sometimes you have to, like, if you have a bug, right, you have to study it under this assembly, you know. It's like, what? Oh, he's loading the wrong register here, or something like this, you know. Maybe it's a compiler bug, right? But we rarely do this because this code is gibberish, and we can only look at a very short fragment of code and analyze it. We cannot analyze the whole program that was compiled, right? So there is this impedance mismatch between our brain and the machine. The computer wants us to write machine language, and the computer does not have to understand this. It can just execute it, right? That's what computers do, and they are very good at executing code. We humans want to reason about code. We want to understand. This is a notion, that this understanding that's totally alien to computers, right? They don't want to understand code. They don't care about understanding, right? They like the machine language. They feed, you know, with machine language. You know, it's like, there are these programs that obfuscate code, right? You know, we write some code, we indent it nicely, you know, we put white spaces, we give beautiful names to our variables, go fetch me some pizza or something like that, right? And then there are these programs that obfuscate code, right? Like they take Java code, for instance, they obfuscate it and says, like, remove all white space, replace all variables with underscore one, underscore two, and so on, right? And they produce code that's equivalent, right? But it's totally unreadable to humans. So I want you to like understand, like, there's this humongous mismatch between what computers expect and what humans can deal with, right? We deal with information in an extremely structured way, right? We like these hierarchies of abstractions, right? This is how we write our programs, right? We build bigger things from smaller things. We have these procedures, functions, right? And we want them to do one particular thing and do it well. Okay, this is a function that gets input from the user, right? And we want this to be abstracted in just a single function call, right, that performs this. We don't want to understand every single assembly instruction that does this. I mean, this could be like, you know, hundreds of lines of code, thousands of lines of code that actually interacts with the hardware to get input from the user. We don't want to do this. We want to abstract. Abstracting means discarding some information, right? So that we can operate on a higher level. And this is almost exactly the description of what mathematicians do. Mathematical language is built for abstracting things. So they keep building higher and higher abstractions in mathematics. And they are using these abstractions at a very high level and building new abstractions on top of them and so on, right? So they actually came up with over thousands of years, okay? It's like this thing started with Euclid, okay? The language of mathematics. So this has been tested over thousands of years. So there has to be something in it, right? We can't just discard it and say, no, we want to use JavaScript. All mathematicians, they're wrong. They should use JavaScript. No, the thing is that, you know, mathematics is we consider it a very hard subject, right? Because it's so abstract. But I think this is because what mathematicians do is they attack very hard problems. So what's reflected is not that the language of mathematics is difficult. It's the problems that they are attacking are difficult. So when we are writing programs and we would like to use mathematics to write our programs, we wouldn't use very complex notions because the problems that we are solving are simpler. Right? We are designing programs that are performing some reasonably trivial things from the point of view of a mathematician. This is trivial, you know. It's like, okay, or quicksort, you know. It's like, oh, this is an exercise for the reader to show that this actually works, right? So what do you do? Well, you just use induction, right? Okay, right? So induction, this is one of these things that we should learn, as you know. It's like, okay, it's a recursion. If you write code that's recursive, then to prove that it's correct, you use induction, you know. So